Good morning and welcome to worship this morning. Please be sure to see your bulletins and our Facebook page for all of the announcements and details about all of the news and events that are going on here at Union UCC. Today we will have virtual coffee hour from 11:30 to 12 o'clock after worship, and this will continue through next Sunday, November 15th. November and December Sunday worship will be online only, but please be sure to watch your mail for a postcard giving you dates about a Grove worship and tailgate lunch on November 22nd and a Sunday sanctuary open house on November 29th.
Good morning. Please join me for our greeting. No matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you are welcome here.
Our call to worship this morning is an excerpt from To Begin With, The Sweet Grass by Mary Oliver. Someday I'm going to ask my friend Paulus, the dancer, the potter, to make me a begging bowl, which I believe my soul needs. And if I come to you to the door of your comfortable house with unwashed clothes and unclean fingernails, will you put something into it? The following story that I'm going to share with you is the story of Maple Avenue Church, told by John D. Cox, in The City in Its Heart, the first 100 years of Maple Avenue Ministries. In the late 70s, a diminishing elderly congregation in Holland, Michigan, began the painful process of looking around the pews and admitting to themselves that they were a dying church within a neighborhood that had dramatically changed in the years since the church was established. Deciding that they wanted to do something about the intensifying divide between church and city, the congregation started a recreation ministry with the hopes of meeting their neighbors, learning who they were, and inviting them to a church that was ready to do it all it could to make room. As the program grew with kids and activities, we invited local artists to come and teach something of their craft. One of these artists was a potter who brought clay and glazes. So someone had the idea to commission the children to create new communion plates and chalices for the church. Many of the neighborhood children had never taken communion or heard the story of the Last Supper. So, with muddied hands, we told the story, and together that summer, several sets of communion plates and cups were fashioned by kids eager to put them to use. I've never seen more colorful, misshapen objects grace the altar of a church. Nor have I ever seen so many wide-eyed children and adults come to life at the communion table. The elders held the lopsided plates and leaking cups, inviting the church community to come to the table of one who also fashioned clay and dirtied their hands with material world, and one by whose love we continue to be shaped. Let us pray together. Skilled potter God, I am your living clay. I am your soft, unformed, and being-shaped mass of earth. Put me in fire, skilled potter. Put me in your own bright fire. I am warm, warm as you, as you from fire. Soft and hard, shaped and purposeful. I am so warm from fire.
I am a small lump of clay here in this large and lovely earth. And yet before I knew my name, you knew my form, you knew my worth. And long I resisted my shape, long I insisted on my own plan. Now I am softening my way and going back to the potter's hands.
This monologue is written by Reverend Glenna Shepherd, Jars for Keeping. The next day we'd gather the wood for the kiln. She'd pack the wood inside carefully, as the wood that burnt a little slow had its place, and the wood that burnt a little faster had its place too. And it had to be right, and then she'd light the fire. And when the fire had really caught, she'd shut the kiln door, and we'd take the time to smooth any rough edges on the newly shaped pot. I had to follow exact directions to get the proportion right, to narrow the lip of a cup or broaden the base of a vase, but she knew exactly how to hollow out the neck so that it would be able to hold a bunch of sunflowers, or how deep to make a mug to hold a pint of ale. And the beauty. and the beauty. How did she always get the right smoothness? How did she know when the oven was hot enough? I could never ask her these questions, and so she could never explain them to me. But then I doubt she could ever explain them to herself. She didn't need to. She just knew. It's part of the craft and the art. Somehow, this knowing we seem to have lost. But it was in every move of her body. I began to think about how she walked and the way that her feet trod the earth. I began to try to walk that way too. I suddenly knew I'd be a potter like her. I would shape sacred vessels and fire them in a kiln, jugs for communion wine and chalices, and we would gather for worship, and at the end, everyone would sip from the cup.
I am a small lump of clay here in this large and lovely earth, and yet before I knew my name, you knew my form, you knew my worth. And long I resisted my shape, long I insisted on my own plans. Now I am softening my way and going back to the potter's hands.
This morning's scripture comes from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 32, starting with the first verse. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the 10th year of King Zedekiah of Judah, which was the 18th year of Nebuchadnezzar. At that time, the army of the king of Babylon was besieging Jerusalem, and the prophet Jeremiah was confirmed in the court of the guard that was in the palace of the king of Judah, where King Zedekiah of Judah had confined him. Jeremiah said, "The word of the Lord came to me. Hanamel, son of your uncle Shalom, is going to come to you and say, 'Buy my field that is at Anatoth, for the right of redemption is by purchase is yours.' Then my cousin Hanamel came to me in the court of the guard, in accordance with the word of the Lord, and said to me, 'Buy my field that is at Anatoth in the land of Benjamin, for the right of possession and redemption is yours. Buy it for yourself.' Then I knew that this was the word of the Lord, and I bought the field at Anatoth from my cousin Hanamel and weighed out the money to him, 17 shekels of silver. I signed the deed, sealed it, got witnesses, and weighed the money on scales. Then I took the sealed deed of purchase containing the terms and conditions and the open copy. And I gave the deed of purchase to Barak, son of Neriah, son of Mahasiah, in the presence of my cousin Hanamel, in the presence of the witnesses who signed the deed of purchase, and in the presence of all the Judeans who were sitting in the court of the guard. In their presence I charged Barak, saying, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, take these deeds, both the sealed deed of purchase and the open deed, and put them in an earthenware jar, and in order that they may last for a long time. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, houses and fields and vineyards shall again be bought in this land.'" Here ends this morning's scripture lesson for all that may hear it. Amen.
Marcia McPhee says that our series on Jeremiah's prophetic visions of hope is in the midst of despair, and it ends with what seems like a bizarre act in today's reading. Jeremiah buys property while he's in prison in a time of overwhelmingly and seemingly never-ending death and destruction of his people, and with no assurance that he'll ever be free again. He chooses a plan for a restored future he cannot yet see. He puts the deeds in earthenware jars and pottery, a common ancient practice for the safe keeping of important documents. No matter what, we are also called to prophecy and to safeguard the dream of a better future for all people. So as we move through this time that we're in, how do we keep finding hope and strength? How do we trust God and in God's timing? How do we keep dreaming in the midst of despair? And how do we plan for a restored future that we cannot yet see? I don't know about you, but I'm not always good at waiting. Waiting takes patience and courage, strength, grace, peace, and much more. We pray for something, we hope for something, we work towards something, and most often, then we wait. We wait. Whether it's something small like waiting for a light to turn green, or for the elevator to arrive on our floor, or our family to be ready in order to leave the house, it's not always easy to wait. Or what about the big things that we wait for? We wait for an answer. We wait for a reply to a job that we've applied to. We wait for a medical test result. We wait to find our soulmate. We wait for election results. We wait for world peace. Waiting is not always easy. Here's a story about waiting for answers to prayers from homiletics. One of the wealthiest Christians in the United States is billionaire Curtis Carlson, who's also a United Methodist. And he's the founder of the Radisson Hotels and other Carlson enterprises out of Minneapolis, Minnesota. Well, he sent his daughter, Marilyn, a card. And the card said, "You're the answer to my prayers." And then she tells a story that when she opened it and saw the rest, it said, "You're the answer to my prayers, but you're not what I prayed for." Has that ever happened to you? You prayed something, and the answer you got was something very different than you had hoped. You prayed for good health, and you get the answer you didn't pray for. Your spouse surprises you with broccoli and brown rice for supper. You pray for a new sense of purpose and direction in your life, and you get the answer you didn't pray for. Suddenly you find that your company has downsized you right out of a job. You pray for family unity, and you get the answer you didn't pray for. You get a late night phone call from your son saying he's all right, but the car's been totaled. You pray for renewal. You get the answer you didn't pray for, and your dog covers you with slobber when you get home and paw prints after a long and hard day. Waiting. Waiting and hoping while we're waiting is not always easy. And it's hard work, even for people of faith. This passage from Jeremiah reminds us some of the things that we can do while we wait and while we work on hoping while we wait. Jeremiah invites us to invest in the future, even when that future is uncertain, and to protect the things that are precious and important for a future, a good future for all of God's people. If we were to get rolls of papyrus scrolls to save in some pottery like we hear told today, what good news would we want to save? What good news about our own lives and the lives of the church and the world would we want to write on these scrolls to keep them safe and protected? What message can we share? What can we be in this time when hoping in the future and feeling safe and secure is really hard? And for some, it's even impossible right now. When the Friday morning Bible study met this week, I asked them to start by introducing themselves and sharing two words about who they are or how their week has been or how they're feeling. And quickly, we heard a lot about how this week has been for many of us. So here are some of their words. One person said, unsettled and optimistic, anxious and hopeful, concerned and cautious, overwhelmed and hopeful, addicted to the news. I was proud of the group because as we talked and shared, they were being real about what's been hard about this time and this week. But they were also still working to hold on to hope and faith in the midst of it all. So you heard all of that roller coaster ride, and even we talked about amusement parks, even though not just a roller coaster ride, but those loop-de-loops, those rides that just take you truly all around. I wrote this sermon on Thursday, and we're recording it on Friday. And I suspect that when you hear this on Sunday, our country's election will still not be decided. And if it is, it will be disputed. So how will we wait? How will we wait, and how will we hope while we wait, and what will we do while we wait? How will we see and invest and hope in a future that we can't see and we don't know? Some of you know that in the last year or so, I've been working hard to create a habit of daily meditation and daily Qigong, and that habit initially came out of my AFib diagnosis, which is great, by the way. But it's been a gift that I've been able to make a habit and a practice that has helped me. And little did I know when I started it a year and a half or so ago, even though these practices have been part of my life almost my whole life, little did I know that it would be these practices that would sustain me and comfort me and ground me during a pandemic and also now during an election. There's a quote from a Buddhist monk that I've been following, Brother Phappai, and he says this about this time we're in. There are so many of us at this difficult moment in time who are anxiously awaiting for the election results. In one sense, of course, there will be a moment in time when the final count will be announced. But on another level, to think that the results are only known at a fixed moment in time may be a somewhat limited view. The results, which are not only numbers, reveal themselves in each and every moment through the way that we look at ourselves, each other, and the world around, the way we speak and interact, and the way we reconcile. This is one of the invitations of this moment. This is what is meant by being the change, and this takes courage. Thanks, Brother Phappai. It's a good reminder and a challenge that there will still be lots of work to do, even when the election results are counted and final and official. And I trust and pray that here at Union, we will find ways to make the election results matter in each and every moment through the way that we look at ourselves and the way that we look at each other and the way that we look at the world. And especially in the ways that we interact with each other and in the ways that we reconcile with each other. The word Amen means, may it be so. May it be so. Let's pray. O love that made the world, we come to you, desiring to draw deeper into the power of your love. May your love transform us. May your love inspire us to create as you are the creator, and we are made in your image. May your love drive us into the work of justice and mercy. May your love envelop and embrace us, especially when we feel beat down and drained. May your love inspire us and guide us and lead us on into the future. And we say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today we recognize and give thanks for those in the military, retired folks, active, inactive veterans, and so join us in the litany that's in your bulletin. God of love, peace, and justice, it is your will for the world that we may live together in peace. You have promised through the prophet Isaiah that one day the swords will be beaten into plowshares. Yet we live in a broken world, and there are times that war seems inevitable. Let us recognize with humility and sadness the tragic loss of life that comes in war. Even so, as we gather here free from persecution, we may give thanks for those that have served with courage and honor. We pray and give thanks for those among us that are either in active duty or reserve duty and their families.
God, we praise you for those that are willing to serve. Let all who serve, serve with honor, pride, and compassion. Do not let their hearts be hardened by the actions they must take. Strengthen their families. Keep them surrounded in your love and peace. We pray and give thanks for those among us that have served in the military in the past.
God, we praise you for those that have served in the military. We thank you for those that put their welfare of others ahead of their own safety. Let us all be inspired by their self-sacrifice and service to those who needed protection. We pray and give thanks for those among us who have lost a loved one in a war.
God, we praise you for those that have made the ultimate sacrifice. We ask that you comfort those that still feel the pain of their loss. Keep us mindful that you have promised to comfort those that mourn. God, we praise you for granting us these freedoms. Let us honor those who have served by working for Let us never forget those that have served, and let us never let go of your promise of peace. Amen.
So during this song, we invite you to stand or raise your hand where you are when the song from your branch of the service is played. And we also invite you to stand or raise your hand to represent a family member. And know that we stand with you and we thank you. Thank you. few announcements and an invitation to our offering. There is a women's wellness event on Zoom next Saturday, so see those details if you'd like to join us. It is free, but you need to register. You'll see there are inserts inviting you to the worship service and the outside service and lunch in the Grove on November 22nd. And start to watch for our holiday mission efforts. We know that a lot of you like to participate in those, so look for information about the Salvation Army Tree, the Shoebox Ministry that goes locally to the Holiday Hope Chest, and then also the invitation to participate in the Reverse Advent Baskets. And now we give thanks to God with our offerings. Closing blessing. We came to this sacred space to celebrate and affirm that God is like a potter, making and reshaping us into God's image to be and share the good news. God, send us out into your world as your change agents to help mold and remake the human condition with your grace and with your help. Let it be so in this age and forevermore. Amen.